How's everyone? I'm fine, but I just discovered that this recording that I've been making for over an hour, and it was really the best one I've ever made, didn't record. 2 minutes of it recorded, and I had the window part where it showed me the recording was covered a little bit, and that the connection to the wireless internet apparently dropped out. And it only recorded a couple minutes, which is a shame, but it's okay. It's okay. I know I can give another talk like that anytime. It's not a problem. But perhaps it was too clear, too extreme for the viewers. That's very possible. But maybe there is a point maybe where I don't want to cover this one up right now. There is a point where maybe the teaching becomes too much as possible, yeah. So maybe there's some grace there said, you know what, that's a little too much. It's getting a little too much. And so there has to be some other way to deal with the situation. For me, it wasn't too much at all. But it did get into the nitty-gritty. It did get into something that you would intuitively know is true, but might make you feel a little unsafe in your situation, in your life, in your living situation. You might say, "Wow, I don't want anyone to know I'm actually listening to this, because it could get me into a lot of trouble." It's getting too clear about what's going on. It's delineating things too clearly. And as I'm using this mic, yeah, okay. Sorry about that. I'm not sure. Let me double check on this, because sometimes you never. Yeah, it does say I'm using this mic. So maybe there is a limit to what can be said. And at some point, there has to be some situation take place that offers some kind of safety. Which is really what I was talking about, which is saying I'm accepting safety for myself. I'm accepting sanctuary for myself. I'm accepting protective custody, as it were, for myself. Willing to do that. And maybe I have to do that before I can really speak out super clearly about what's going on. I woke up this morning with a super clear clarity about what's taking place in the world. Obvious, completely obvious. And so I spoke about that. But it gets into the situation that, you know, that is here, that is taking place right in front of our eyes. And the clarity on it was just super clear. And people don't feel safe, and people are not safe, actually, at all. So people want to maintain some feeling of safety with what's going on in the world. So they think, well, maybe if I just act like I don't really see what's going on, that'll give me some measure of safety. Well, it will temporarily. It will temporarily. That is true. But the price you pay for that is that you get in even deeper and over your head. And so eventually you'll feel like you're really trapped. So for me, speaking out is my safety, because I'm clear what the options are. But For most of you, maybe you feel like, if I don't know exactly what's taking place, at least I have some sense of safety, and I want to have some sense of safety, especially on Thanksgiving. So it may be necessary that I get myself into a place of safety and know that it is possible, and test this out, because I say that the grace of God will put us in a place of safety. Because the grace of God in no way is asking for any harm to come upon the body mind. In no way. Because reality is not threatened by this hypothetical scenario whatsoever. And God loves what God created so perfectly, completely perfectly and flawlessly, that even when we're engaging in this hypothetical scenario, God is not still perfectly loves the fact that we're doing this. And so there's no call for any non-love for anything that is within this hypothetical scenario. So there's no call for any attack of anything within this hypothetical scenario at all. God cannot attack anything. God is perfect love. So God just says, overlay the whole situation with perfect love for us, to accept the overlay of it. Not so that means nothing should be harmed at all. There's no call for any body mind to be harmed, including this body mind, including your body mind. So there is the grace of God should, and I'm counting on it, that it will provide safety for those who choose safety for the body mind, who don't want to use the body mind as a means to attack some other body mind. And I got into very explicitly and clearly what the whole attack scenario is in the world, and who's who, and who's on what side and this side, and how it's going to play out. But it was so specific that if you were listening to this, you might feel like your own safety is being undermined a little, you know, too much. I can definitely see how that would be, that could come about. I don't want to do that, because actually the safety of your body mind is paramount. And I have to show that by saying the safety of my body mind is very important, simply because the body mind, seen rightly, is nothing but a communication device. But it's an important, the fact that this hypothetical scenario we call existence needs communication devices to communicate within this scenario, that it's only a hypothetical scenario, an attempt to figure out a way to adapt to a problem which is never going to arise in reality. That's all that it is. So it's necessary to have communication devices functioning flawlessly here to help. And so you cannot have the body mind being attacked under those circumstances and compromise, etc. That is not helpful. That is not helpful. That is not the will of God at all. So if I accept my own safety, protective custody, sanctuary, refuge, then that will help convince you that this is what I am accepting for myself, and there is this safety. You'll say, ah, okay, there is a way, and it's not so risky to see what's going on clearly then. There is a way, a remedy to sidestep this trouble. But if I don't accept it for myself, how can anyone really trust in what's being said? They're going to start to get frightened, like, wait a minute, this is getting too clear, and that's kind of unsafe. I got to at least kowtow to some belief system, so, you know, some belief cult. You have to give evidence that I'm have allegiance to something of belief here. And if I see that the clarity of, you know, none of belief is completely insane, I will not be seen to be backing any either side, and both sides will want to get rid of me. And this gets too scary. So I can totally understand that. Totally understand it. So, but I'm just waiting for this, you know, for me to be put into a safer location for sure. It hasn't happened yet. So I want to say something. I want to keep on sharing clarity and reassuring everyone. But at the same time, I need to be put in a safer location for sure. Because for sure, if what I am saying is heard by certain people, they're definitely going to say off with his head. He's a distraction from success. He's a supreme distraction from are being able to succeed at what we're trying to do. But see, I know there is no possibility of success. So it's not really a distraction at all. How can you distract from nothing? It's not a distraction. But in their insanity, they will see it as an extreme distraction. And if you're paying attention to this extreme distractor from their standpoint, then you are aiding and abetting this distraction, and you too can be seen as being an extreme distraction to so-called quote-unquote success. So it does get dangerous. It does get dangerous, and there is a need for safety. There is absolutely a need. That's how I see it. I'm not someone who's so cavalier, saying, oh, I can go out and say anything and there's no problem. Oh, that's bravado. That is stupid bravado. I'm not that way. I'm very much aware that You know, you can't be John the Baptist saying anything you want to say in the king, the Salome, the power behind the throne says off with his head. You know, says the king, you get, grant me one wish, king. King says, okay, I grant you one wish, whatever it is, I'll grant it. Say off with John the Baptist's head. You know, you can't be that level of bravado, because that doesn't help anything. It doesn't help to have John the Baptist's head off. You know, that doesn't help. We need communication devices here. Very important. And God does value that. Absolutely does. Knowing that helps the plan of salvation, the true plan of salvation, which is to see that this entire scenario that we believe we're in, we're not even in it, to start, for starters. Two, why it's simply, it's the mind using creativity in the form of imagination. It is imagining all of this. This is all being imagined. Three, it's simply a hypothetical scenario. Four, it's a modeling of a problem that we anticipate is going to happen in reality at some point, somehow, but it hasn't happened yet. And we're trying to, we think we're super smart to model it and figure out how to adapt to it ahead of, before it happens, so that when it happens, there'll be a seamless transition, and we'll already know how to be happy with, how to adjust and be happy with this problem, with this new kingdom, supposedly. New rules. New kingdom, new rules, new laws. And we'll already know how to adjust to those laws and love how to live, love those laws. And so we're just modeling this problem in our imagination. Our mind is imagining it for us. And we are modeling it, and we're trying to figure out a way how to learn to love it, how to learn to live within these new laws, new laws, a new kingdom. And the fact is, that kingdom will never arise, because the problem, the change in reality, will never take place. Never. So we don't need to come up with any results in this hypothetical, in this modeling, and we don't need to learn to love it. We don't need to learn how to adjust to it. We don't need any results at all, good, bad, or indifferent, none, which is why we can accept the overlay of it, which is one effect, one result. It's just an overlay. It's not even an effect coming from this modeling, but it is an overlaying of all effects, so you only experience this one effect, which is this overlay called love. But really, you're loving the overlay. Love is coming from you. It's perfect, seamless, unchangingness. It's the overlay. That's the remedy. That is the remedy. So we don't need any results from this. Yet the world is hell-bent on getting results. It's just arguing over what results and how to get them. And the arguments are becoming very severe, very severe. And if you are sitting here saying we don't need any results at all, they'll say, all sides will say, you know, you are, you know, get out of our model. Die, is what they'll say. You must die. And I say, no, I must communicate this truth. And so safety is all important. I know they're there to say, take no thought for your safety. Well, that's fine for those who realize that they're perfectly safe, who are imperfect, who already accepted the overlay. But what about those who have not? Of course they need safety. Of course. You cannot just cavalierly say, take no thought for your safety, and go out and just start blah, 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 blah. That's bravado, you know. That's stupidity. Those who are perfectly awake, of course, they're safe, because they know they're not even in the dream, this hypothetical. They're not in it. They know, and so they simply say, effortlessly say no to any interference with their communication. But it's effortless. It's not an effort. So to say, take no thought for your safety as an effort, is not right advice. You absolutely should ask for protection. Absolutely should ask for protection. Insist upon it. How else are you ever going to get to the point where you don't realize you don't even need any protection? What you are doesn't need to be protected. And therefore the protection is just effortless. How else are you going to get there under the circumstances if you don't accept protection from those who would certainly like to see you out of the picture entirely. And you think, oh, I'm just such a small fish, that who would want me out of the picture? Well, the situation that is brewing in this world wants everyone out of the picture who is not fanatically devoted towards obtaining results along the lines of what belief is attempting, what we're attempting with this hypothetical modeling of this problem. And the fight is over which results to get, how to get them, and what results to get. And there's severe disagreement now over that. There's two camps that are loggerheads with each other. And yet belief is demanding that we go along with one of those two camps, certainly that we not set it out. Well, that's the worst. That's what belief is. Off with their heads right now, that you can't sit it out. Can't sit on the sidelines. Anyone sitting on the sidelines is worse than useless, because they're giving a bad example to those who are working hard to get results, and we can't have that bad example. So they need to be invisible. How do you make people invisible? You kill them and put them in the ground. They don't make them invisible. That's how belief does it. So we have every right to accept sanctuary. Every right. But somebody has to get the ball rolling on that. So others can see, hey, it is possible. Yeah, sanctuary is possible. So that then they can trust in their clarity to the point where they see the situation very clearly. The situation is very clear right now. This morning I woke up and I said, holy cow, it is right in our faces, completely blatant at this point. Right at this point, it is blatant. It is completely obvious. But it is not being, people are afraid to speak out about it, because they feel their safety will be compromised if they do speak out about it. I can speak out about it, but maybe that might even be reckless. You know, I don't know if that's bravado or not, because I'm not really in a safe situation at all. Just the opposite. I'm in a very precarious situation. So the next step might be safety. You know, so accepting some situation that is very much insulated and is not easily attacked by those who would want you, you know, out of the picture. By those who see no desire for results is setting a terrible example. Terrible, terrible example. It's not. It's setting the best example. But the mood of the world right now sees it as setting a terrible example. So of course those who are communicating this example need to make sure their safety is assured. And I'm humble enough to say, hey, I'm not one of those who is simply going to be go around and positive my safety is assured. If that is not what I see, that would be bravado. And bravado is not called for. If you don't see it perfectly well, then, you know, you should not be engaging in bravado. That is for sure. Because then you're going to set a bad example, because you are going to get in big trouble, and others will say, oh my gosh, I better not say these things, otherwise I'm going to get in big trouble. So the question of what to do. Someone suggested, one of the great viewers here has suggested, I write a book. And that's, someone long ago said that someday I'd be writing a book or something. But I don't, you know, certainly I could write a book, but I don't, maybe I should, maybe I shouldn't, I don't know. I don't have any desire to write a book. But maybe, you know, this is the time to write some book. But again, the issue of safety is actually paramount. Because if you know, write a book, I'd put very clearly what's going on in the book, most likely. And that would, people would feel they're not safe in reading it. It'd become like one of those underground books, like, who has a copy? You got a copy? Or people say, oh, you know, this is a dangerous thing to be reading this book. So I don't know. The way I see it is accepting sanctuary is primary. And maybe within the acceptance of that sanctuary, maybe I would write a book. and continue taping also. I could do both. But I can say in video, I can say what is being said in a book. Maybe having hard copy of a book is more seems more secure than having something on the internet, which could be banned at any moment. The site could go down at any moment. Violation of terms or something. Violation. They can cook up some violation of terms, saying that you're not. You're preaching, what you're preaching is no results, is totally counter to the whole spirit of the internet and everything and blah, blah, blah. And so we're going to violate our terms of service. Therefore, we're taking your site down, and then poof, all the videos are gone. Whereas if you have hard copy, you can have hard copy of the videos because you can download them. There's lots of programs that download programs. You can download them all. You just Google it, YouTube download programs. You can do that. Because these are all Creative Commons, put a public domain. And so you can have hard copy on your computer. But some people might want to have hard copy as a book, whereas a book, they can take it with them, outages of electricity will not cause any problem, right? Which is why I like books better than the internet and all this stuff. Because you, if electricity fails, are just jammed, or you don't want to be traced by what you're viewing, etc., etc., you have a book, and there's no way for anyone to know, you know, what book you're reading necessarily. See, there's no smartphone logging everything you're doing, right? There's no tracing or tracking of everything that you're paying attention to if there's a book. So I actually prefer books. For certain things, in certain ways. Video, this has its place also. This has its place also. But I can understand how some might want a book at this time to be able to reference and not feel threatened that somebody is paying attention to what they're viewing. So that may be a problem too, is there may be some, maybe at some point they're monitoring, you know, of who's viewing the videos and then logging your IP, check, you know, recording your IP and knowing who you are. And people are saying, wow, that could get me into trouble at some point, which it certainly could. Let's not be silly about it. Of course, there's an intense monitoring going on at this time of the internet and what people are viewing and paying attention to. There's a reason for that. They're trying to. There's algorithms that will be used to determine, you know, who is engaged in trying to obtain results within this hypothetical scenario and who is not interested in results, as it were. Absolutely. So it's a very important issue to look at. So I don't know. Maybe I will write a book. Just as a means of service. Not that I'm any ultimate authority at all. I don't have any ultimate perspective. I've not stood up to the bully of belief perfectly. I've not chosen the overlay. I know that there are those who have done so, so they are certainly way more qualified than I am to write anything. But on the other hand, I do have some clarity about the situation, some ability to stand up to belief, and it might be of some help. Possibly. I don't know how I'd publish it. I don't know. Publish it online and then have people make download it and print hard copy is probably the way to do it. But I'm not really sure how to do that. I imagine there's some way to stash a document online and then just have people download it and then print it. Yeah, I'm sure it's very simple. In fact, I can find out how to do that. That's possible. That's possible. Thanks for the suggestion. Yeah, why not? But the sanctuary thing is super important for me. Super important. It always has been. Because I saw it taking place. I saw what's going to happen in the world. And it is unfolding just the way it was shown to me. I saw that I'm going to get help in sanctuary. That is going to take place. It just hasn't happened yet, and it's getting very late in the game, It's later than we realize. Very much later than we realize. Situation has deteriorated to an alarming extent. Older people don't realize it so much because there's something about when you get older, you just do get, in some ways, you get stupider. You tend to just say, well, what we don't realize is how fast generational changes are taking place. When older people, change happened much slower in the past, so there was not such a great change from one generation to the next. So when you get older, you just assume that the younger generation are kind of like you. They're kind of like the same. They're very much the same. Little differences, you notice differences. We don't realize that generational change now are off the charts. That just one generation or two generations removed from what we are extremely radically different than we are. Have super different viewpoint. It can be extraordinarily activist in ways that we never imagine. And so older people just assume, hey, you know, the younger generation is just, you know, a little bit different than we are, and they have the same value. No, they don't. Do they have the same appreciation of history that we have? You know, the same realization of how things, the danger signs, red flags, can they recognize those? No, they don't. No, they don't, by and large. There is an extreme difference now. And my generation and older, we just assume that it's pretty much the same. That's a very dangerous assumption to make. I never assumed that. You know, I said, wait a minute. We cannot assume that. Let us just stay aware. Just stay aware of what's going on. And so I did. I just stayed aware. And I'm aware of the level of activism and the level of emotionalism, the desire to obtain results is so extreme in the younger generation. So extreme. And in some of the older generation, the baby boomers and my generation, that a lot of that generation also went the way of trying to extreme effort to attain results in this world. And some did not, like myself, did not. Sort of pulled there, but I was able to get the right mentors, and they said, no, don't go that way. So some of us did not go that way. But the thing is those, even though the baby boomers are trying to get extreme results, they don't realize that the younger generation have the tools that they believe, and so they are hyper, incredibly focused on obtaining results beyond anything the baby boomers could imagine, really. And so they're not aware of that. They are not aware of it. If they were, they would say, uh-oh. Now I have some, those who in Latin America who are aware of the troubles down there and aware of the criminal gangs, et cetera, down there. And they have told me that the criminal gangs, the older criminal gangs down there, you know, the older ones, 40s and the 50s and 60s, you know, the older people who have these criminal gangs there, they are absolutely terrified of the younger people, gangs. Because they can never imagine the level of ruthlessness that these younger gangs, what do these younger gangs want? They want results. And they're not willing to wait for the results 1 second, which is why they're incredibly ruthless. It's the same principle at work, is that the older activists who are super focused on getting results, they at least saw the results, they have to wait and have to work at it for a while. The younger people who are super focused on getting results, they want it right now. They're not going to wait. They're not going to wait on anyone changing. They're going to say, either give me the results now or get out of the way. Boom, like that. So the baby boomers are not aware of this. They're not aware of it. They are sort of worrying about it, which is why some of them are watching these videos, because they're kind of feeling like, whoa, there might be a problem here. Well, I'm telling you for sure there's a huge problem, and it's not a small problem, it's not a joke, it is an incredible problem, and it's beyond a problem, it is an incredible threat, because those with younger people who have these tools, who are super used to using these tools, getting immediate results, They want immediate results in society and culture. They want immediate results of compliance, of being on the same page, of agreeing to belief. And I went into that, into the video that didn't record. I went into that in great specificity and clarity. But they want results now, right this minute, and they feel entitled to these results right this second. And they are feeling that now is the time to get these results. So when we talk about December 21st, etc., people say, ah, that's nonsense. Really, it's not necessarily nonsense. The mood, just like in the Latin countries, for instance, where you have these gangs, it's all over the world, really, but this is just, for example, you know, they think nothing of committing the most insane atrocities over a minor desire for a minor result. They want to smuggle drugs in the United States. They want to use those people who want to sneak into this country as mules to carry the drugs. And these people say, no, we don't want to do that. They think nothing of massacring all of them, massacring them immediately, on the spot. Nothing of that. Because they say, hey, we want results now, and you're not willing to give us those results, they simply massacre them. That is the mentality that is in play in this world, is those who are not willing to give us immediate results are only worthy of destruction, nothing else. Immediate destruction. That is literally what is at play at this time. And the older people, we don't realize it. So I have tried my whole life to reach the older people, my generation and older, saying, folks, you need to be wise, very wise, what's coming. And by and large, they thought I was just talking to the moon, you know, talking to myself. They think, change never happens that fast. I said, no, it is going to happen that fast. I was born aware of how fast the change is going to happen. And so I've tried to deliver the message, you're going to be stunned and shocked by what's going to happen, because the change, the demand for change will be so fast, and the demand for results will be so extreme, and you will be seen as getting in the way of that non-compliance, and the way that you'll be dealt with will be extremely severe. And they say, no, change has never happened that quickly in all of history. We know that. We're intelligent. Don't insult our intelligence. That's what I got. Everyone said, don't insult our intelligence. I said, I'm not insulting your intelligence. I'm just augmenting it. And they say, well, who do you think you are? Do you think you're so smart? I say, well, actually, I am, yes. And they say, well, why don't you why don't you be some guru then or something? I said, well, I just am what I am. I don't need to be some guru. I don't need to be wearing flower lei or anything. I'm saying it's not that level of intelligence I'm talking about. So they kind of said, well, it was kind of, you know, a dismissive thing, like, well, if you're so intelligent, go set up some great movement. Maybe we'll listen to you if you go set that up. But I said, it's not that much more intelligent. It's just pointing out a facet that's important to look at. Just be aware. Just put in the effort. Put in the effort to see what's happening. Don't be caught unawares. And essentially, Jesus was saying that in the Bible. He said to everyone, in that time, in the end times, you have to be very aware of what's going on. Don't get caught unawares. All his parables were about being hyper-vigilant to the times you live in. Don't get caught unaware. You know, all these parables, you look at them, he's just saying, be vigilant. Be aware of what's taking place so you don't get caught. When the time comes, it'll sneak up on you like a thief in the night, meaning the demands for rapid compliance will be so extreme. It's like those drug smugglers saying, hey, either you agree to smuggle right this instant, right now, we're going to massacre you. And that's what they do. They can't say, well, maybe next trip we'll do it. No, this one. So we have this whole situation that's arisen in the world now, where there's extreme demand for results from this hypothetical scenario of how to adjust to this hypothetical problem that supposedly we believe will eventually arise into reality, even though it never will. This whole thing is completely ridiculous in the first place. But within this belief, within this scenario, there's a demand for results. We need to get this. We need to learn to love existence. We need to learn to adapt to it right now. We need the results now. And we have the means to, believe we reach those results right now. Right now, we have it. All this high tech, social media, internet, high tech, all this stuff. We have a way to enforce compliance, get everybody on the same page, and the result that we're looking for is simply to everybody agree that we've reached the result. Everybody simply to agree. So it's compliance. It is control. And we have the means to institute this in a way, faster way than we've ever had, exponentially faster way. So the older generation doesn't see that coming, doesn't see it coming at all. They say, we got plenty of time to get out of the way. Plenty of time. No, we do not. And so I've been this broken record my whole life saying, folks, you've got to be prepared now. You've got to be vigilant. You've got to get ready now, because it will come upon you like a thief on the night. And you won't have time to prepare when it comes upon you. Because your whole thing is like, well, we always have more time to prepare. No, we've always, no, it can't come upon us that quickly. That's not possible. Yes, it can. And some of you are saying, yes, it can, right? You're hearing this, say, well, wait a minute. Well, this is accurate. This is true. It can come upon us that quickly. And you're saying, uh-oh. Yeah, uh-oh, that's a good reaction, uh-oh. See, like a free fall happens more quickly than like an avalanche. If you have like an avalanche, it rolls down the mountainside, right? Its speed is slowed by the inertia of picking up more and more snow and more and more snow and all of that resistance, etc. What if you had this massive amount of snow that simply free falling through the air? There's not much resistance in the air, much less resistance, right? And the pull of gravity, and it was a straight down rather than an angle down a hill. It's going to, that snow will reach you way, way faster than the avalanche coming down the hill would reach you, way faster. So what we're having in the future, what I was shown, is a free fall, an absolute free fall. And that happens much more quickly than something rolling down a hillside happens, much more quickly. So I know there's a lot of people in the world who realize there's troubles coming, but they don't realize how fast they're going to arrive. They don't. They don't realize it's going to be a free fall. They do not. And that's the whole thing Jesus was pointing out, is saying it's going to be a free fall. And Jesus, the spirit of truth within me, within all of you, pointed out to me very clearly, it's going to be a free fall. And it's going to catch the world unawares, because nobody in the world, hardly anyone, realizes how fast it's going to come upon the world, how fast it's going to come upon. Because of the ability now to bring about results super fast. And there's a whole generation or two that are super proficient in this, at bringing about super fast results. And the older generation, in no way do they realize how fast these results can come upon them. So for them, it'll be like a free fall. And unfortunately, I haven't been able to reach many of them, simply because they just assumed I was, what do you call it, arrogant or presumptuous or audacious in saying these things. Like, who are you to say these things? Are you Jesus? You know, that's what they say to me. Who are you? Are you Jesus? I say, no. Well, then why? How presumptuous of you to be able to know the future and tell us how to prepare for the future. We're going to listen to Jesus. Well, that's fine, I said, but make sure you get it right. I should have said, I'm not Jesus, but I work for Jesus, which is true. The true Jesus, not the believed in one, but the actual one, that which is the sonship. And what Jesus said, the warnings Jesus gave in the Bible were actually absolutely accurate. It's, the problems will come like a thief in the night. For those who are prepared, they'll know, say, hey, we have to get out of harm's way, of course. They won't be caught unawares. He said, make sure you're not caught unawares. So, you know, people would mockingly say that, like, and so it kind of quieted me down, you know, quieted me down. I could have done a better job for sure, but I'm still trying. And people say, "Who do you think you are? You really think you must think you're Jesus?" And I say, "No, Jesus is Jesus. I'm not Jesus, but I'm certainly a friend of Jesus. That is for sure." And I certainly have a certain enough clarity to see what is not so difficult to see. It's not so difficult. When those people say, "Oh, you must be really smart," what they're really saying is they're very lazy, because it doesn't take a whole lot of effort to see this. It doesn't. It just requ it requires the love of truth, enough love of truth that you're not willing to delay your experiencing of truth. And to drop this hypothetical scenario and experience the overlay of it, you're not willing to delay that. That's all it takes. If you love truth enough, you won't be willing to go into another cycle of delay. Therefore, you're not willing to get caught unawares by what is coming, which is another cycle of delay for sure, and also great harm to the body minds here in this world, especially to those who are not engaged in trying to attain those results. And from the standpoint of those who want to obtain results right now, the older generation is way too slow. Get out of the way and bulldoze them. They're going to be bulldozed. They're going to be bulldozed. And I could say a lot more about this, of how exactly how it's going to work. But again, that might put you, may give you a feeling of a lack of safety, so I won't do it at this point. I mean, if we got into a discussion and we started talking about it, we could pinpoint it pretty accurately what's going to happen. And it's all in place. It is all in place for this avalanche, this free fall to happen. It's a free fall. It's not an avalanche, it's a free fall. It is a massive, like a massive snow and ice free falling on us, as it were, a massive burying, going to be buried. We're going to be buried. Now, I'm going to escape from it. I'm going to sidestep it. That is what I've chosen to do, because I've seen it coming, and I can maintain my viability to help others as they're buried. It certainly is possible to pull people out of, you know, an avalanche. When an avalanche hits, it is possible to pull people out of it. Absolutely is. Absolutely, it is possible. But it is not possible for someone else who's buried to do it. If I get buried along with everyone else, how can I help pull people out of the avalanche? They're buried, you know. It's not possible. You have to. A search and rescue team cannot be the ones that are deeply buried in the avalanche. That is obviously crazy to count on that, rely on that. So I cannot be buried. Those who have enough love of truth so that they're aware of what's coming, certainly have to maintain their own safety and viability, so then they can help pull out others who didn't quite see it coming. They just couldn't, you know, their love of truth wasn't quite strong enough yet. It takes a lot of love of truth to see what's coming. That is for sure. That is true. It takes a tremendous love of truth to see through it. Tremendous. So it is not like a judgment saying that those who get hit by this avalanche, and by the way, if you're on the fringes of it, you won't be buried so deeply, so you'll be able to be pulled out. Okay, so keep that in mind. Obviously, if you are kind of trying to get away from it, but not entirely, you're going to get somewhat buried, but not so deeply, so you'll be able to be pulled out. So keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. Very important. But just because you get sort of partially buried by it doesn't mean that you don't love truth a lot. It just means maybe you didn't love it quite enough to, you know, get out of harm's way ahead of time. But that is not some, you know, judgment on you at all. It takes a tremendous love of truth to see it and to sidestep it ahead of time. Tremendous. And sometimes that tremendous love of truth can come about because there's been a tremendous suffering and a tremendous desire to get free of that suffering, and then you see the way to do it, and then you spend the time on it and determination, and then that the help you get builds the love of truth, builds the love. And that's what happened with me, partially what happened. That the suffering was so terrible, and I did get the help from truth, and that I've grown to love truth more and more because I see it is the way. It is the way, and it's showing me the way. It is showing me the way. And has shown me the way. So that I have a great love for that. Because I know it's going to free me from that suffering, which is great. That'll be a great day when I can look and know that there's no way I'm ever going to be pulled into that suffering ever again. That'll be the day that I celebrate for sure. I haven't reached that yet, so I'm not celebrating. But that will perhaps be my day of celebration. Which would be a great celebration, no doubt about it. Very great. So the love of truth is here, which would lead to sidestepping ahead of time, getting free of the free fall, getting out of harm's way before the free fall happens, or as it's happening, fleeing to safety, as it were. And I've seen that I will do that. And then, presumably, help pull others out of the however they're buried. Help pull them out of it as much as possible. There's some that'll get, you know, deeply buried. Of course, you have a horrendous avalanche. Some get very deeply buried. And they get buried in delay. The avalanche is an avalanche of delay, is what it really is. It's an intense insistence on results, getting final results. You know, final answer. You see these trivia shows, final answer. Come on, final answer. We want results. We want your final answer now. So it's a tremendous drive for compliance, for everybody to agree that these are the results we've agreed upon. And because we agree upon them, they are effective results. In other words, it's the opposite. It's like reversing. It's like effect saying, because we all agree this is our cause, it must be our cause. But it's a cause that we agree upon and we establish. We can establish our own cause if we just all agree upon it. There's this tremendous demand for compliance, and the demand will be right now. Whereas the older generation say, well, yeah, there's this pressure, but it gradually builds, and they don't realize it's going to happen right now. We insist upon your compliance right now. It's going to be a free fall. I mean, this means it's going to happen way faster than we expect, than we're used to. Faster than I'm used to, which is worrisome to me. Because even I don't quite get how fast it's going to be. I don't really, because of the older generation, we cannot fully see how fast it's actually going to take place. So we need help for those who do see it. We need help, and we should just pray. We should ask for help for those who do see how fast this free fall of demand for results is going to take place. We ask that they get us out of harm's way prior to this free fall taking place. And if we are a little bit tardy in that, we ask that they whisk us out of harm's way, you know, as soon as we're willing to be whisked out of harm's way. That's just a very great prayer to make. That we be whisked out of harm's way, you know, so we don't get buried. We don't get buried. I could make quite a funny play on words with "so we don't get buried," but maybe I will not do that at this point. But maybe you can put two and two together. So we don't want to be buried. And we certainly don't. So, the apocalypse is now. Welcome to the apocalypse. Welcome to the unveiling. And the unveiling really can take the form of what it is unveils the gifts, what the gifts are. And those who want results, within belief, within this hypothetical scenario, will get the results they are praying for and want, which is to be buried in results, in compliance, in supposedly everybody being in the same situation, which is buried in this avalanche, as it were. And there's those who want the results of freedom from delusion, freedom from this hypothetical scenario, they want the overlay. They will get their results, and they'll be whisked away to safety. So the time of that unveiling, which is what apocalypse means, is here. It is going to take place very soon, so it's a tremendous time. Don't lose heart at this point in time at all. Just the opposite. Be very expectant, like the best is yet to come, and it's going to come very soon, because the unveiling will come. So I'm really looking forward to it. Very much looking forward to it. Not fearing the future at all. Opposite. It's the opposite. And we'll talk more, I'm sure, some point. So have a great Thanksgiving. Or if you're viewing this later, I hope you had a great Thanksgiving. I don't pay any attention to Thanksgiving, really, because, like I said, we're in a crisis. We are in a severe crisis. We're in the apocalypse, and maybe your Thanksgiving was just a time to be aware of the situation that, wow, it really is polarized. Oh my gosh, look at this. Look at what's going on. You can see the red flags. You'll probably see it your Thanksgiving. You'll see the red flags. You'll see the divisiveness, the feeling of we need to reach results in this hypothetical scenario. We need to reach results. We need to have results. And again, the freedom, the real freedom we are seeking and we will find, is the realization that we need not be seeking any results at all. We need not to be worried about any results at all in all of existence, in all of time and space. We needn't care, not the slightest bit, for any results. We simply accept the overlay of all time and space to maintain a sense of continuity, and that's it. That's it. That's the realization. And you say, well, that's too lofty a realization. No, it's not. I'm very clear and keen about it right now, and I'm just hanging out here and just like everybody else. I'm not floating on some cloud or anything. So it's not too lofty a goal. Not at all. Not at all. It is the only goal there is. How can it be too lofty? Like there's some other goals? No, they're not. There's not. If you just see it, that's the one goal, then it doesn't seem too lofty to you at all. Belief makes it real lofty to scare you, to intimidate you. It's not too lofty. You can realize you don't need to pay attention to any results at all in existence. You don't need any results from existence. You don't need any results at all, because the problem that existence is modeling is never going to arise in reality. Never, ever. Therefore, why do you need any results from this modeling? You don't. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Anyone in this world could understand this, plain and simple. Not a problem. It's just that belief intimidates them. Says, that's too lofty of a goal for you. What are you talking about? Oh, let Jesus get that, but you can't reach that. You're not Jesus, you know, blah, blah, blah. Of course, Jesus said you have to reach this result that he pointed out to us. He says, you must be as I am, meaning knowing that no results are necessary within this hypothetical. That's what Jesus knows. No results. You don't need any results from it. You don't need to pay attention to any results. You don't even need to be aware of any results. Just accept the overlay. Be as Jesus is, knowing he needs no such results, because Jesus knows that this problem, hypothetical problem, that we believe is going to arise in reality will never arise. So we don't need any results of how to adapt to it. We don't need it. Any. None. Zero. That's what Jesus knows to be true. And since it is true, all of truth must know that it is true. And we are one with truth too, so we must know that it is true. So we must be as Jesus is, knowing the truth. and knowing we don't need any results from this hypothetical scenario, and abiding in the overlay, simply abide in the overlay. That's not some kind of lofty result. That's the only result there is. How can we say the only result there is some super lofty result compared to what? There isn't any other result we're looking for. It just is what it is. And you just see it that way. It's just is what it is. It's the one result. It's the only result there is. So why term it lofty compared to what? Lofty compared to what? Some other result? No. So belief tries to intimidate and scare us away by saying, oh, you must think you're some real be egotistical. You think you can reach that ultimate lofty result? Who are you to think you can do that? You must be an egomaniac or something. That's just belief intimidating us, bluffing us. That is the only result there is. That is the only result we're called to. It's truth itself. It's reality itself that calls us to that result. And says, this is it. This is the only result there is. And you're entirely deserving of it. Everyone. And there is no other result possible. So lofty? No. It's simply accepting what is inevitable, what must be. How is that lofty? There's no concept of loftiness in reality whatsoever. All in all has all. That is the way of reality. There's no unloftiness to it. If there's no unloftiness, how can it be lofty or high? There's no lowness to it, so how can it be high? There's no ungreatness to it, how can it be great? You know, the whole thing about concepts, there are no concepts in reality. Because reality has no opposition, nothing other than reality, so how can there be any concepts? There cannot be. So, there you go. And your Thanksgiving was probably, if it's, I don't know how mine's going to be, but I can imagine how it's going to be. Yeah. Red flags everywhere. And maybe you're dismayed, like, oh my gosh, you know, can't we all get along in this time? Do we have to be, you know, this arguing about how we can attain results and whether how fast we're going to go and should we really do this and all this turmoil? Yeah, well, that's what's taking place. That's what's going on. It really is going on. And of course, the younger folks are looking at the older folks like, hey, they don't know how to get the fast results. They're not into it. It's up to us. It is all up to us. That's what I get from, you know, most of the younger generation. Not all. Some younger generation are great, really great. But the ones that are super activists, they say, it's all up to us. We're the ones because we know how to get fast results right now, and that will end the whole thing, and we'll know how to adapt to this problem that hypothetically we're modeling, and we'll get the answers. We're the ones who are going to find the answers and provide the answers. We're the sayers. We're going to do it, and we're going to do it when? Right now. None of this waiting around. Look at the old folks like, the old folks, they're never going to get it. Look at them. And they have this kind of scorn, you know, for the old folks like useless. Absolutely useless. They're not going to get it. And there's that, you know, there is that feeling, I'm sure, that some are feeling that, like, wow, they don't have a very high opinion of us. They think we're too slow. We're too slow. We're not going to get the results. But guess what? We don't need to get the results because we don't need any results from this hypothetical scenario. So our slowness should not be judged as a very bad thing. We're not wicked, evil, useless eaters, you know. Not at all. As a matter of fact, that slowness can be turned to our advantage by recognizing that we don't need any results at all. How about that? So I value older people. Always have. I value their slowness. I value them not being so engaged desperately in trying to get results, because theoretically they can be turned towards, hey, evaluate the fact you don't need to get results. And they might say in their old age, they might say, aha, I kind of see what you're saying. But mostly the older people were too engaged in going to their clubs and playing bridge and just trying to keep themselves occupied, trying to keep themselves active, you know. They didn't quite use it all. So older age can be used effectively, actually. It just isn't very often. I always value older people, still do. I value inactivity. It's great. It's just people don't know how to use it properly. Even people on their, you know, just really incapacitated, they can't do anything anymore. I say, hey, use this time. It's super valuable time for you. You can actually see that inactivity, not getting results in the world, is great because you don't need any results. You don't need any results at all. And choose the overlay instead, and they might be able to see that. They say, I can't move, I can't do anything anymore. I say, wait a minute. So what? So what? I can experience the overlay right now. Even though I can't even move, I can experience the overlay. I'm in total bliss right now. Very possible. Doesn't happen very often because their expectations aren't there. They just feel like I'm kind of pretty useless now, and that's too lofty a goal for me. You know, they believe in that. That's too lofty. I really can't do that. What have I done in my life to deserve that? What did I do as far as obtaining results in my life to justify that? Nothing. If no results are needed, how do you need results to justify recognizing that results are not needed? That's a complete... See that? That is a trap, isn't it? You talk to older people and they will tell you, well, yeah, it's great what you're saying, but what I've done in my life, I didn't bring world peace. I didn't get the results, money results. I don't deserve this. I say, well, wait a minute. If no results are needed at all, then how is it that you need results to justify recognizing that you don't need results? Hello? See? This, huh? Hello? Hello, hello, hello? And you'll say, wait a minute. Yeah, that doesn't quite add up, does it? No, it does not. Doesn't quite add up. See, but everyone has been intimidated, that they need to get results in order to be... get some benefit, you know. The reward comes from results. I haven't gotten any results in the world of my life, so based on that, I don't deserve any reward at all. So I shouldn't be expecting it, right? No, because I know, again, we don't need any results from existence whatsoever, none. Therefore, the fact that I haven't gotten any results in no way disqualifies me from recognizing that I don't need any results, and accepting the overlay of all results. In no way does it disqualify me. In no way could it possibly disqualify me or anyone. To say it disqualifies is insanity. Just insanity. I just pointed out the insanity of it here on this tape. How can we feel we're not qualified to experience some great reward if, in fact, we don't need any results to obtain results at all? And seeing that we don't need to obtain any results brings the reward. How is it that then not having enough results in this world somehow disqualifies us from that? How? It cannot possibly disqualify us. You see a complete impasse there. You just saw this logical, reasonable, complete impasse, right? Complete disconnect with reason there. Complete disconnect. Which is the engagement with belief. But you can see there is a disconnect with reason as you engage with belief. We just pointed out the disconnect, clear as can be. You don't need to disconnect with reason. There's no reason to. because it's not going to deprive you of any reward. The overlay is the reward for realizing, recognizing you don't need any results in existence. That is the reward. That is the reward. So how do we need to obtain results to get that reward? It makes no sense at all, does it? None. None. Zero. It's kind of full stop, isn't it? So maybe that's for something appropriate for Thanksgiving, is to point this out. Something to give thanks for is to see the full stop very clearly. Because wait a minute, why am I believing I don't deserve, I haven't earned this great reward that you call the overlay, because I haven't brought about enough results in the world? How can I say that when the overlay comes from recognition that I don't need to obtain any results in existence? How can I say that I'm not deserving then? It doesn't add up at all. That's nuts. Totally crazy. What belief is saying is totally crazy. Saying that I don't deserve it because I haven't got enough results, when the deservingness comes from seeing that I don't need to get any results at all. See, two completely different criteria. And then the choice, then you have to choose which one is sane and which is insane. So the choice then becomes obvious right there. You can see that you can't reason your way out of that box. It's a choice at that point. One must be lying to you, and the other must be telling the truth. They can't both be true. They cannot both be true when you see it this way. Truth is saying you absolutely deserve it. You deserve it. Why? Because you don't need any results at all. At all. You don't need any. Therefore, you're deserving right now, aren't you? This very second. Before you have a chance to try and attain any more results, you're completely deserving, because the whole issue is you don't need any results. So you deserve it right now. And belief will say, you don't deserve it right now because you haven't done enough results to deserve it, so you have to keep working on it. That's what belief will tell you. That it's a reward for obtaining results in existence. So one puts it in the future, one puts it right now. I guess what the teacher says, you deserve it right now, full stop right now, is that's what they're getting at. They don't explain it the way I explain it, particularly. They have their own ways of explaining it, it seems. It would seem. The full stop means that you see it as a choice instead of an argument. There's obviously no argument at all. Once I put it this way, when the way I just put it, is not a question of argument. It's simply a question of they both cannot be true. So there's nothing to argue about at that point. When you see they both can't possibly be true, then there can't be an argument. It's a choice. Because you see the position of each one is clearly laid out. There's no argument. You see the positions of both, this option and that option, these are the positions. What is there to argue about? At that point, it's simply a choice. And it's not a matter of figuring out a way to make them both true. Because obviously there isn't a way to make them both true. Can't possibly be. See, there's no way to fit those together. Each one denies the other. How can we say we're undeserving? The question of whether we deserve it or not is put on two completely different bases. We deserve it because no results are needed. That's because of what we are, always are, what we are and have always been. That's why we deserve it. We deserve to recognize what we are. Because of what we are, recognition of what we are is not based on any results. What we are is not based on any results in a hypothetical scenario. So we don't need to have achieved anything in existence. It's a total moot point. Whether we've achieved a lot or nothing, it's all exactly the same. What your achievement is, my achievement, everyone else's achievement, it's all exactly the same. No achievement is needed. And no achievement gets in the way of the overlay. The overlay overlays everything. All achievement and all non-achievement overlays it equally. Because it's all equally irrelevant. All equally irrelevant. We can say I deserve it right now because I don't need any results. And what is the future? I'd only believe I need the future if I believe I need results. Because right now there's no time to generate any results. So if we say I deserve it this instant, that is essentially choosing the overlay, choosing a different idea. That is essentially it. That is accepting the effects of it. Effects right now. I don't need any time, more time to earn these effects, you see. This effect, the overlay. I don't need time to earn it. Therefore, I can accept it right now, this moment. Because I know I can't earn it. There's no need to earn it. Earning it is completely irrelevant. Effects within existence is simply how to adapt to what we presume will be a different self than what we are. That is all it is. How do we adapt to what's a different self? Why do we need results in adapting to a different self when what the self that we are always will be what it is? We don't need to learn to adapt to a different self, so we don't need those results of adaptation to a different self at all. We don't need them. And that's all that time is, in time and space and situation. That's all that it is. That's all that it is. We don't need it. We don't need any of those results. And yet, for the sake of continuity, we'll accept the overlay of all those attempts. We'll accept the overlay of all those attempts. So, it can be made very clear. It can be made very clear, and that's helpful to make it very clear, point out very clear what's going on, and that and you can see the choice very clearly. There has to be difference between truth and insanity there. You have to see, there has to be a difference, a meaningful difference that's seen there. Very meaningful, because one requires time. Which effort requires time? One does not require time or effort. There's a meaningful difference, isn't it? It really is. And they can't both be true. One that says it absolutely requires time, the other says it absolutely does not. How can they both be true? They cannot both be true. One is definitely different than the other, coming from a different premise, of course. And the premise is, one comes from the premise that what we are, our identity is going to be changed in the future, and so we're modeling this changed identity and trying to learn how to be happy with that changed identity, and we're working on results of how to be happy. The other says our identity is never going to be changed, and therefore this results of how to be happy with a changed identity are completely unnecessary, and we can abide in that, the love of our identity in reality right now. We don't need any time at all, because time is only required for results. So they both can't be true, and the meaningful difference can be seen there. that is basically, you know, that is how teaching goes. And it seems as though there are different styles of getting to that. Someone just say, what is wrong with right now? You know, full stop, what is wrong with right now? And try to throw you into that. Kind of shock, jump, you know, push into the pool kind of thing. And then others simply look at it and say, aha, 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 aha. Different style. Based on the kind of results that we're used to trying to get, you know, so that changes the style of what you'll listen to. Based on what kind of results have you been trying to obtain in existence, because we still believe that those are valuable up until the point where we finally realize they're not. So we have to go along a path which honors what we believe is valuable, until we reach the point where we realize no effects. No results in existence are valuable, none. But up until that point, we'll still see some as valuable, and those have to be honored. So you have different teachers having different styles, really, depending on what kind of results we've been honoring. So this way is a particular way to honor some results. And the results here have, maybe are along the line, different lines of very careful, meticulous like bringing about something that's very beautiful, very well thought out, something that's extraordinary, that type of results, which is along the line of my endeavor in the past. The results that I were trying to bring about was something very sublime and extremely subtle and extremely exquisite, and therefore I value this very reasoned, very calm, clarifying, you know, what looks best, what seems, you know, most sublime, most subtle, most beautiful, etc. I value that type of approach, but that's not the approach of of everybody. Others have a very different approach. Others have the let us just bring about intense control and results right now, kaboom. And so those who value that, they'll listen to a teacher who has the kaboom approach. Like, what's wrong with right now? Boom. Full stop, boom. Like that. And they may spend a lifetime listening to that. Hey, full stop, kaboom. And eventually they'll get it. They'll get it that way. It's not necessarily faster. Just because somebody uses a full stop right now, what's wrong with right now, kaboom approach, that is not necessarily a faster approach. Because like those who come to them, like I say, might spend a lifetime before they get it. But that's the approach that they, how do I adjust this? That is the approach that they can use, because they have value that type of approach to trying to get results in existence. So there's not one way for everyone. There's not one teacher for anyone. A universal curriculum, a universal approach is impossible, as Jesus pointed out. I sort of took issue when he said a universal curriculum. Now, the curriculum's the same for everybody. It's set. But a universal approach is not possible. And I agree 100% with that. It is not possible. Because the ways that we've been trying to obtain a result, to adapt and love a new self, a changed self, a changed identity, automatically takes on many different, because it's impossible, it takes on many different ways of trying to accomplish this. And we have habitual value of those different ways. So we will listen to the way a teacher who values the way we've been trying to attain results. That is a given. That is a given. I'm trying to adjust this. The light is changing on me. We will value that. So we will all, everyone will have a slightly different approach, and they will go towards different types of teachers. Those who are helping them, they will go to different types. You'll never have. So those who come into the world and say, I am here to establish a universal religion, a universal approach. I wonder what's wrong with them, you know, because it's not possible. Why would they say that? It shows some kind of unawareness. It's not possible. But the light is really changing now. It's not possible. And it's foolish to try and impose that upon the world. That's another result that's trying to be imposed on the world. Let's all find, everyone take the same approach. In other words, let's get on the same page. That is just more of the same delusion. It is more of the same delusion. It's just making it seem like it's a good result. We don't need any results. We don't need to bring about a universal approach, a universal religion. Not at all. Not at all. That is totally delusional to say such a thing. Doesn't matter if there's a million billion different approaches to realization. Doesn't matter at all. The number of different approaches doesn't matter at all. No need to categorize them at all, catalog them. No, but there are basic different ways that we have valued trying to find results, and there are basic different ways that we approach realizing we don't need any results, because as we approach this, we'll still be valuing some result. We'll still see it as a result, so we'll value the certain approach that we have seen in the past as valuable to obtain some results. That is fine. That is inescapable. It is unavoidable and inescapable, and doesn't need to be avoided or escaped. It does not, because again, we're not concerned with any results in existence. None. We're not concerned with the result of how we got there, how we get to recognition that we don't need any results, because that itself is concern about some result. Not even concerned with that. But it is certainly worth pointing out that trying to establish a one-world religion, one approach, unifying all approaches, is nonsense. It is nonsense. That in itself is an attempt to find a super result in existence, which is super delusion. It's just more delay. It'll just cause more delay. So if you're one of those who have valued the big boom, you know, result type of thing, like let's go in there and just wipe out the whole village. Let's just take over and institute control. Boom! Let's just do it like right now. Then you'll gravitate towards the approach of what's wrong with right now, full stop. What's wrong with right now, full stop. What's wrong with right now, full stop. And just hammering away at that. Jump in, come on, jump in. You'll value that approach. It seems like the quick approach, you know, quick result, approach to get quick results, which is what you valued in existence. You're habituated to that and familiar with it. Again, it's not necessary the faster approach, just because it was supposedly a faster approach in trying to get results in existence, doesn't mean it's a faster approach to realization that you don't need any results. It simply is the way that's going to work fastest for you, because you're valuing it, and that's where your value and your attention will be. So you might spend 30 years listening to a teacher go, full stop right now, what's wrong right now, boom. Boom, 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 come on, boom, boom, boom. And you might spend 30 years at that, and then you might get it. Or you might spend 10 years, you might spend 5, I don't know. But someone else might take a different approach of the Yani approach of careful differentiation between truth and lies, which is the path I've taken. And they may spend 30 years at it, or they may spend 10, or they may spend 5. But for them, that will be the quickest approach. Whereas the other who's doing the full stop right now approach, they might say, oh, that approach is so slow. Why is this so slow? That's crazy. No, I want a fast results. Because within existence, there are those who thought the way to do it is get these fast results, boom. And there are others that say, wait, it's more difficult than that. We're going to have to go about more slowly and give more effort to it. And so they're used to the more careful, slower approach. But the way to undo both of them is this: take the same amount of time, actually, same amount of time. It's not different. It's not really different as far as time goes. So, you know, we can stop judging which approach is faster, because the fastest approach is the approach that is using the way that you are accustomed to valuing trying to attain results in existence, using that and valuing that. That is the fastest approach for you. So there is no fastest approach for everyone. The fastest approach is that which works, which is best suited for each one of us. That is the fastest approach. So I might have been a little judgmental in the past of looking at some other approaches, saying, wait a minute, that, you know, there's something that isn't quite right. Well, it wasn't right for me, that is for sure. The what's wrong with right now, full stop, boom, approach is not right for me. Never has been. Doesn't mean it's not right for others. And for them, they don't want any explanation. For those who are trying to attain results through ruthlessness in this world, they don't want any explanation. They want you to agree right now. So they're going to go to a teacher and say, I want you to agree with what I'm saying right now. Ruthless teacher, you know, ruthless. So I guess the styles of teachers are vary greatly. And I may have been, you know, a little judgmental, not quite seeing it clearly enough. But there are also some of those teachers who are not real teachers at all, who are actually trying to obtain results. And that's what I've been trying to point out. Within these different real teachers, there are quite a few teachers who are not the real McCoy, and who are just trying to tell us that, yeah, we know the way to obtain the results that you want, that will make you worthy then to get your reward, which is what everybody believes they need. They need to obtain some results that make them worthy to get the reward that they know is there, you know, bliss. Those are not true teachers. And they can appear to be very similar to genuine teachers. They can appear very similar. So it's been a great taping. I was able to do this another video after the other one failed to record. And it's just as good. It's just as good. Maybe even better. Maybe even better, actually. I would say it is better. Did a better one. Left out some of the elements that were a little too clear as far as what's going on in the world, and got into something which is actually extremely beneficial. So I've done a great work here, and everything's in play. Welcome to the apocalypse. Welcome to the unveiling. It's a great time to be in here. So hang in there and just dispassionately observe what's going on. Notice the red flags. Say, okay, there is a way. I don't need any results. All right, very great. That's it for this one.